إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن نبينا وسيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بين يدي الساعة بشيرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا، صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أبي بن كعب رضي الله عنه was one of the greatest and most illustrious companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. At times the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would receive revelation from Allah سبحانه وتعالى, verses and passages from the Quran, and he would go to Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu and he would recite them to him immediately. In one such incident, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to Ubay, "O Ubay, indeed Allah commanded me to recite these verses of the Quran to you." So Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu said, "O Messenger of Allah, did Allah take my name from above the seven heavens and command you to come to me by name?" The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said yes. And this single incident shows the virtue of this great companion radiyallahu anhu. He was from the scholars and the people of the Quran, from the most knowledgeable companions about the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why when Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu came to compiling the Quran, one of the companions that he chose was Ubay ibn Ka'b. And when Umar radiyallahu anhu was the Khalifa and he would lead the people in prayer, then the person standing directly behind him was none other than Ubay ibn Ka'b. And he would give him this great virtue and this great status because of his knowledge of the Quran. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to Ubay radiyallahu anhu one day and he asked him a question that is one of the most important questions concerning the Quran. He said, "O Ubay, ayyu ayatin fi kitabillahi azam?" From this Quran, 114 different surahs spread over 30 ajza, over 6,000 verses, ayyu ayatin fi kitabillahi azam? Which single verse from amongst all of those verses is the greatest single verse of the Quran? What is the greatest verse of the Quran? Now we know from our religion that from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized the importance of certain passages of the Quran. Surah Al-Fatiha, Surah Al-Ikhlas, the last two surahs of the Quran, Surahs Falaq and Nas, Surah Al-Mulk, the last verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, all of these parts of the Quran, Surah Al-Kahf on a Friday, they have a special virtue in our religion. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wasn't asking about any particular surah or any part or passage of the Quran. He wanted to know the greatest single verse of the Quran. So Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu, out of respect for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of humility and humbleness, he said, "Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam." Allah and his messenger know best. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew that Ubay ibn Ka'b was a person of the Quran, a companion of the Quran, a scholar of the Quran. So he repeated the question again. "O Ubay, ayyu ayatin fi kitabillahi azam?" What is the greatest single verse within the Quran, within this book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Ubay radiyallahu an, since he was being asked this question the second time, since the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was repeating the question, he replied and he said, "O Messenger of Allah, it is the verse, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum, ayat al-kursi." So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam touched Ubay on his chest and he said, "May Allah always increase you in knowledge." My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this single, simple hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam illustrates a point that should be at the forefront of our minds. That we have this book from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a book which Allah azza wa jal describes as a light and a guidance and a source of mercy and a cure and so many other descriptions that Allah gives to the Quran. And from the mercy of Allah azza wa jal is that He hasn't asked us to study all of the Quran at once, because that would be difficult and it would take time and a lot of effort. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized certain portions of the Quran over others. Certain parts and passages and surahs of the Quran are emphasized in terms of their virtue, so that me and you, we as Muslims, know that these are the parts of the Quran that we should concentrate on first as well. Suratul Fatiha, described as the mother of the Quran. Suratul Ikhlas equals a third of the Quran. The last two verses of Suratul Baqarah, from the verses that you recite before you go to sleep. These different parts of the Quran, Suratul Kahf and a Friday, gives you a light from one Friday to the next and protects you from the Dajjal. And so we concentrate on these parts of the Quran. And so in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ is saying, from all of those passages and all of those verses and all of those different surahs, the single greatest verse is Ayatul Kursi. And that is not new news to anyone sitting here today. That's not new information. All of us already knew this. And that's why when you go into someone's car, you'll find Ayatul Kursi on the mirror. You go to someone's house and they have it in calligraphy. You go into the masjid and you find a poster, all of them, Ayatul Kursi. So the question isn't whether we know how important Ayatul Kursi is or not. But the question is, do we understand what Allah is saying to us through this verse of the Quran? What is the meaning of Ayatul Kursi? What is the message of Ayatul Kursi? What is Allah Azza wa Jal trying to relate to us through the single verse of the Quran? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in another hadith, again to add and emphasize the virtue of the single verse of the Quran, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if a person after every single obligatory prayer, after Fajr and Dhuhr and Asr and Maghrib and Isha, if they were to recite Ayatul Kursi, then nothing will stand between them and Jannah except their own death. That's all that stands between you and Jannah, for you to die, meaning you will have Jannah, because you recite the single verse after every single obligatory prayer. The Prophet ﷺ said in yet another hadith, that if you recite this verse of the Quran in the morning when you wake up, then Allah will protect you until the evening. And if you recite it in the evening, then Allah will protect you in the morning. And the Prophet ﷺ said in yet another hadith, that whoever recites Ayatul Kursi at night, then Allah will descend upon him his protection, and shaitan will not be able to harm that person until the morning. And so on, and so on, and so on. So many ahadith that speak about the virtue of a single verse of the Quran, Ayatul Kursi. So the question is, what is the meaning of Ayatul Kursi? And even though it is a single verse of the Quran, it would be extremely difficult, nigh impossible, for me to give you a comprehensive overview and tafsir of this single verse of the Quran. So great is its meanings, so comprehensive are its words, so beautiful is the message that Allah Azza wa Jal is trying to relate to us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allahu la ilaha illahu. Allah begins this verse, the most important verse of the Quran, He begins it with the most important issue that any individual needs to know, and especially me and you as Muslims. And that is the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, none has the right to be worshipped except Him. He is Allah Azza wa Jal alone in terms of His Lordship, for He is the Creator and the Provider and the One who gives life and death, and He is the One who decrees harm and good. It is Allah alone that created everything in this universe. And so therefore Allah alone deserves to be worshipped. So when we pray to Allah alone. When we fast for Allah alone. When we perform Hajj and Umrah, it is for the sake of Allah alone. When we give charity, it is for Allah alone. When we make dua, it is to Allah alone. When we sacrifice or take an oath, it is for Allah alone. All of the acts of worship that we perform are for Allah alone. Why? Because no one has the right to be worshipped except Him. And this is not only the beginning of this verse, but the most important and fundamental message of the whole verse. In fact, of the whole Quran. In fact, of the whole religion of Islam. That you worship Allah alone. Not associating anyone in worship with Him. When you pray, you don't pray to impress the person next to you, or to impress your father or your brother, or to impress anyone else that may be watching. It is for Allah alone. When you give charity, it's not to help someone or to please someone. It is firstly and foremost for the pleasure of Allah. And then everything else is secondary. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, Allahu la ilaha illa hu. And then He mentions two of His most beautiful names and attributes. Al-Hayy, Al-Qayyum. That Allah is the ever-living, never dies. Everyone else in this universe will die. I will die and you will die. And the people that are closest to you will die. And even though we act as if we're going to live forever, each one of us will die. So why then when I have a need, when I need some help, when I require some support, would I go to someone as weak as me, if not weaker? Why would I not go to the one who is all living subhanahu wa ta'ala, who will never die, who never becomes ill, who never sleeps, who never tires, who never rests? And He is Al-Qayyum, the one who is self-sufficient, yet at the same time He suffices everyone else. Allah doesn't need our dua. Allah doesn't need for us to come on this day of Jumu'ah and listen to this khutbah and pray in this prayer. Allah is free. Allah doesn't need the help of a partner or a son, doesn't need the companionship of a friend, for He is Al-Qayyum, self-sufficient. Yet at the same time, He provides for everyone else. From the smallest drop of water, from the way that your blood circulates, from the air that you breathe, from the pennies that you have in your pocket, all of this, everything in the universe, it is Allah that helps it to suffice. It is Allah that provides. It is Allah that has control over everything. And so He is Al-Qayyum. So why would you go to anyone else when you have a problem? Be that with your family, be that with your children, be that with your job, be that with financial issues, be that with your studies. Why would you go to the people around you who are weak, who need to sleep, who tire, who forget, who make mistakes, who don't have the ability and knowledge to help themselves, let alone help you? Why would you not go back to Allah, Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum? And then to illustrate that point, Allah says, لَا تَأْخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. Allah Azza wa Jalla does not become tired, nor does He sleep. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if all of the people, all of the people of this world were to come together, and at the same time they were all to raise their hands up to the heavens, and they were all to make dua and ask Allah for all of the needs that they have, then Allah would be able to listen to all of them simultaneously. Despite their different parts or their different locations across the globe, despite the different languages that they speak, despite the different needs that they have, and Allah will not become confused. And Allah will not become tired. And Allah will not become bored. And Allah will not want them to stop. But Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who listens to everything. And He hears everything. And He sees everything. And He knows everything subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. And to Allah belongs everything in the heavens and the earth. And that's why when the prophets of Allah went through so much difficulty and they went through the trials that they had to endure, they wouldn't turn to this person or that person. They wouldn't turn to their parents or their children. They wouldn't turn to the people around them. Yet they would turn to Allah first and foremost. And that doesn't mean that you can't seek help from others. But what it means is that your first port of call should be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why when Ibrahim alayhi salam was thrown in the fire, he turned to Allah. And when Yunus was in the belly of the whale, he turned to Allah. And when Ayyub was overcome with disease and illness, he turned to Allah. And when our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam on the battle of Badr, on that great day, the most decisive of days when the Muslims were outnumbered 3-1, he turned to Allah. Why? Because Allah controls everything in the heavens and the earth. And not only in our life, not only in the dunya, but even on Yawm al-Qiyamah. مَنْ ذَلَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. Who can intercede on your behalf except with the permission of Allah? Why would you want your salvation to come from someone who is weak? Why do you go and think that those people who are weak immaterial, insignificant in the sight of Allah, why would you go and ask them for help? You turn to Allah. And that is the beauty and the essence of worship. That it is so simple, yet so powerful. You don't need someone to intercede on your behalf. You don't need people to come in between you and Allah, even though you are so insignificant and Allah is so great and powerful. From the mercy of Allah is that you can come directly to Him. That you can make dua to Him. That you can pray to Him. That you can worship Him. And Allah Azza wa Jal hears and sees and accepts. And He knows everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why on Yawm al-Qiyamah, salvation will be given only to those people that Allah wants salvation for. No one will intercede on that day, let alone intercede, they will not even speak on that day, except without the permission of Allah. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said that no one will enter Jannah except by the mercy of Allah. They said, O Messenger of Allah, not even you, even though all of your sins have been forgiven, past, present and future, and you're the greatest, most beloved of the creation of Allah to Allah. Not even you, O Messenger of Allah, he said, not even me, unless Allah bestows His mercy upon me. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said that from the people that will come on Yawm al-Qiyamah is a man who in this dunya all he did was worship Allah. From the moment that he was able to worship Allah, he became a man. Until the moment that he died, all he did was worship Allah. Prayer and fasting and charity, all he did was worship Allah. So when that person will come on Yawm al-Qiyamah, they will say, Oh Allah, I don't want to enter into Jannah because of your mercy, but I want to enter into Jannah because of my own actions. All I did was worship Allah. Never sinned, never disobeyed Allah, never slept on a prayer, never forgot to give charity. All I did was worship. Oh Allah, I want to enter into Jannah because of my own actions. And so Allah will weigh up his actions on one side of the scale. And on the other side of the scale, Allah will place all of the blessings that Allah has bestowed upon him. From health and family and safety and security. And Allah will place all of those blessings on the other side to see which of the two scales is greater. And when that weighing is done, it will be seen that all of his lifetime of worship has only equaled half the blessing of eyesight. Only half the blessing of eyesight. Let alone his speaking and his hearing and his smelling, and the fact that he has 10 fingers and 10 toes, the fact that he can walk and talk and understand and comprehend, only half the blessing of eyesight. So when that man will see this, he will say, Oh Allah, rather your mercy, Oh Allah, enter me into Jannah because of your mercy. And so Allah will enter him into Jannah because of his mercy. So why then would you go and seek help or intercession from anyone other than Allah? يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. For Allah knows everything that has taken place in the past, and Allah knows everything that will take place in the future. And that is the beauty of when you call to Allah. If you have a problem or an issue, and you have to go to your parents, you have to go to your children, you have to go to your husband or wife, you have to go to your friend or your relative, you have to go to a therapist or a doctor, then what you have to do is explain the issue to them from beginning to end. And even when you finished explaining, they probably still won't understand fully and completely what you're going through. And even though you may have an illness which many other people around you also have, they won't be able to truly appreciate what it's doing to you, how it affects you as an individual. But the beauty of worship is that when you turn to Allah, you don't need to mention the backstory. You don't need to mention your past history. You don't need to say, Oh Allah, this is how the issue began. This is when the trouble began. For Allah is all hearing, all seeing, all knowing. He already knows better than you do. And Allah understands you better than you understand yourself. And Allah is more merciful to you than even your own parents would be to you. And so therefore, when you turn to Allah, all we simply do is raise our hands and make dua. We ask Allah for the solution. We don't need to mention the story and the issue and the problem. We only ask for the solution. For Allah knows. And then when Allah Azza wa Jalla decrees something for us, that solution or the issue that will solve our problem, Allah does so with infinite knowledge and wisdom. If I was to give you advice, I can only give you advice according to my own understanding, according to my own experience. And I don't know what the future holds, neither for me nor for you. But when you turn to Allah, Allah has infinite wisdom, infinite knowledge, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah knows what will happen in the future. And so when Allah decrees, He decrees the best of things. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءٍ. And all that you have in knowledge in comparison to the knowledge of Allah is that which He has given you. Allah has given us very little of knowledge. Allah has given us very, very little of knowledge from the knowledge that He possesses. But with that knowledge, we're able to live our lives. We're able to have families. We're able to work. We're able to live in communities and societies. But the true knowledge exists with Allah. And that's why Allah says, وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. Above every single person of knowledge is the all-knowing subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is always someone more knowledgeable than you. And above all of the people is the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بَارَكَ اللَّهُ لِي وَلَكُمْ فِي الْقُرْآنِ وَالسُّنَّةِ وَنَفَعَنِي وَإِيَّاكُمْ بِمَا فِيهِمَا مِنَ الْآيَاتِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. أقول ما تسمعون واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولجميع المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه كان غفارا. الحمد لله على إحسانه والشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له تعظيما لشأنه وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي إلى رضوانه صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وإخوانه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. الله سبحانه وتعالى continues and he says in آية الكرسي وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض. Allah Azza wa Jal gives to us the parable and example of how great and vast His creation is. If you were to go out and travel around the world, you would see mountains and you would see oceans. You would see the most beautiful scenery and natural beauty that you can ever imagine. But this is only a speck in the ability and the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that all of the dunya and everything within it in the sight of Allah is only equal to the wing of a mosquito. Why? Because it's insignificant. What is more significant in the sight of Allah is the day of judgment and the fire of hell and Jannah and all of those other types of creations that we cannot even begin to comprehend or fathom, let alone see or hear. And so Allah gives that example. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. The footstool of Allah is far greater than all of the heavens and the earth. Just the footstool of Allah. And the Prophet ﷺ said that the example of the footstool of Allah compared to the heavens and the earth is like the example of a person who was to go in the desert, the middle of the desert, and they were to take a ring off their hand and they were to throw it in the middle of that desert. That is how the footstool of Allah is compared to the heavens and the earth. Just the way a ring would diminish from that great desert. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, and the example of the throne of Allah, the arsh of Allah, compared to the footstool of Allah, is again like a person going into the middle of the desert and taking off a ring from their finger and throwing it in the middle of that desert. That is how great the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal is. And the Prophet ﷺ told us that there is an angel of Allah, just a single angel of Allah. The distance between its earlobe and its shoulder is the distance of 700 years of traveling. 700 years of traveling. And the Prophet ﷺ would sometimes see an angel, and the angel was so great that it would fill the horizon, and he wouldn't be able to see anything else. That is a single angel of Allah. That is a single creation of Allah. And there are millions upon millions of angels, let alone what Allah Azza wa Jal has created over and above them. That is the creation of Allah. And so Allah Azza wa Jal is not poor. Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't go through austerity. Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't have times where there are financial issues. Allah Azza wa Jal is ever rich. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever powerful, ever having the ability to create and provide for His servants. And so when you turn to Allah, you're not turning to someone who has a limited budget. You're not turning to someone who has only a finite amount of resources. But you're turning to one who creates what he wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he gives what he will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is so easy for him that all he has to do is command, say, kun, be, and it is. وَلَا يَؤُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا. And all of this creation, all of the dunya and the akhirah, everything within it, all of the billions of people within the world, all of the jinn and all of the animals and all of the plants, none of this tires Allah. Allah doesn't become tired looking after the universe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't tire. And that's why when you turn to Allah in prayer, despite all of the things that Allah azza wa jal looks after, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the guardian over, when you turn to Him in prayer, Allah will turn to you. Allah turns to you, and He listens to your prayer, and He listens to your dua. And when you recite Surah Al-Fatiha, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, then Allah responds to the verses of your Fatiha that you are reciting. And that's just not special treatment for you or for me, it is for every single Muslim. Over 1 billion of them currently in the world. Allah has the ability to do all of this. And so why would you turn to other than Allah? And then Allah concludes the verse with another two great beautiful names and attributes of His. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. And Allah is the Most High, the Most Great. There is no one greater than Allah. No one more powerful than Allah. No one who has more ability than Allah. And if all of the people that were ever created from the time of Adam until the day of judgment, if all of them were to come together, as Allah says in the Hadith al-Qudsi, all of them, men, women, jinn, human, all of them from the beginning to the end, and all of them came together at the same time, and all of them asked Allah, and they made dua for all of their needs, then Allah would respond to all of their needs. And all that would diminish from the kingdom of Allah is like a needle that you place in the middle of an ocean and you lift it up. How much of that ocean comes back with that needle when you take it out? How many drops? That is how vast the kingdom of Allah is. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the message of Ayat al-Kursi, that we need to go back home and reflect on and understand and contemplate over and study deeper, it is the Tawheed of Allah. It is the ability of Allah. It is the infinite power and wisdom and knowledge of Allah. So then therefore me and you, as people who worship Allah, as slaves and servants of Allah, we need to turn back to Allah. We need to strengthen that connection with Allah. We need to bring ourselves closer to Allah. For that is the only way that we will achieve salvation in this life and the next. ثُمَّ عَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَكُمْ بِأَمْنٍ بَدَأَ فِيهِ بِنَفْسِهِ وثنى فيه بملائكته المسبحة بقدسه وإياه بكم أيها المؤمنون من جنه وإنسه فقال قولا كريما إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وزد وعلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين الأئمة المهديين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر الصحابة أجمعين والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وعنا معهم بجودك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله العظيم الجليل يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه وآلائه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون.